Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Mario Ritter Jr. and John Russell. Later, Bryan Lynn brings us this week's science report. Finally, we hear the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first, here is Mario Ritter Jr.
African health officials say Mpox infections on the continent have risen by 160% in 2024. They expect the spread to continue, they say, as Africa lacks effective treatments or vaccines for the viral disease. The Africa Centers for Disease Control and Prevention reports that Mpox, also known as monkeypox, has been identified in 10 African countries this year. Burundi and Rwanda both reported the virus for the first time recently. New outbreaks were also declared this week in Kenya and Central African Republic. On Wednesday, Kenya's health ministry said it found Mpox in a passenger traveling from Uganda to Rwanda at a border crossing in southern Kenya. In a statement, the ministry said that a single Mpox case was enough to require an outbreak declaration. The Africa CDC has reported more than 14,000 cases of the disease. More than 96% of cases and deaths are in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Earlier this year, scientists reported the appearance of a new form of Mpox in a Congolese mining town. They fear it might spread more easily among people. Mpox spreads through close contact with infected people, including sex. The Africa CDC said the Mpox death rate is 3%. It said the rate has been much higher on the African continent compared to the rest of the world. During the global Mpox emergency in 2022, less than 1% of people infected with the virus died. The version of Mpox in the Democratic Republic of the Congo could kill up to 10% of people infected, experts reported. The center noted that both of the Mpox cases in Rwanda had been in Congo before testing positive. A study of patients hospitalized from October to January in eastern Congo suggested that recent genetic changes in the virus were the result of ongoing spread in people. In earlier Mpox outbreaks, patients suffered lesions mainly on the chest, hands, and feet. The new form of Mpox causes less severe symptoms, and lesions mainly appear on the genitals. The Africa CDC said nearly 70% of cases in Congo are in children younger than 15. That group also represents 85% of deaths from the disease. The agency said the number of deaths across the continent has jumped by 19% since last year. The medical aid group Doctors Without Borders called the expanding Mpox outbreak worrying. It also said the disease has been found in camps for displaced people in Congo's North Kivu area, which shares a border with Rwanda. Dr. Louis Massing is medical director for Congo at Doctors Without Borders. Massing said there is a real risk of explosion given the huge population movements in and out. Mpox outbreaks in the West have been uncommon because of vaccines and treatments. But few treatments have been available in African countries, including the Congo. In May, the WHO said no donors had provided money to fight the spread of Mpox. The Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations is an aid organization based in Norway. It recently announced the start of an Mpox vaccine study in Congo and other African countries. It aims to learn if vaccine treatment given just after infection could prevent severity of the disease. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Singapore's House of Seafood restaurant is the country's first eatery to offer insects to customers. The change comes after the city state's food authority recently approved 16 kinds of insects for humans to eat, including grasshoppers, grubs, and mealworms. Crickets and other insects have long been eaten as street food in Southeast Asia. But the wealthy financial center places heavy safety and cleanliness restrictions on food imports. Francis Ng is the chief of House of Seafood. He said customers love it when the dishes bring attention to the insects. For example, the restaurant offers a tofu dish made to look like bugs are crawling out of it, and a dish of rice balls decorated with silkworms. It looks scarier so customers can film it for their TikTok, said Ung. He added that customers had been calling him regularly to plan a tasting of the dishes. The restaurant has created a menu with 30 dishes that feature insects, which they can sell to the public once their importers are approved by the food authority. For now, Ung is offering free samples. In 2019, Singapore declared it was aiming to produce 30% of its nutritional needs by 2030. Currently, around 90% of food is imported. Food security expert Paul Tung said insects could certainly help move towards this goal if people got over the yuck factor. Most insects are almost all protein, said Tung. Tung added that there needs to be local production to make this new way to get protein less costly. Getting people to accept insects in their diet is a challenge, but really, it's a normal food item. Let's do something about it to prepare the consumer for it, he said. Me personally, I have no problem eating insects. The United Nations has said bugs can be a sustainable way to get protein to feed the world. The UN estimates the global population will reach 9.7 billion by 2050. Extreme weather and conflicts have also increased the interest in insects as high-quality, low-cost nutrition. In Singapore, all insects approved for human food must be farmed in a controlled environment. The insects cannot be taken from the wild. And they cannot be fed materials like human or animal waste or rotten food, the food agency says. There has been local interest in importing insects, but cost remains an issue for now. Ung said insects make up 10% of his costs at the House of Seafood, and they are all imported. The price is definitely higher than eggs, he said. It is too early to tell if insects will become an important part of the Singapore diet, or whether demand will decrease as it has for fake meat products. But for now, some diners say they are happy to develop a taste for bugs. If they have a higher source of protein, why not? I'll add it to my daily meal and daily food intake, said Bregria Sim, a 23-year-old logistics executive. She added that she would be willing to pay about $30 for the unusual dishes. I'm John Russell.
A Mars Explorer operated by the American Space Agency, NASA, has captured a rock that scientists say shows possible signs of ancient microbial life. NASA said in a recent statement that the Perseverance Explorer, or Rover, collected the rock on July 21st. Scientists working on the Perseverance team nicknamed the rock Chiava Falls, after the tallest waterfall in the Grand Canyon. The rover's exploration area is believed to include a former river valley measuring about 400 meters wide. The valley is thought to have formed by water rushing into Jezero Crater billions of years ago. Scientists believe the area around Jezero Crater contained large bodies of water in the distant past. NASA's statement says the rock shows signs of chemical signatures and structures that could possibly have been formed by life billions of years ago. NASA team members based their findings on examinations of the rock with imaging equipment and multiple scientific instruments. But they noted that additional research is needed to confirm a history of microbial life. The examinations did suggest the rock contains organic compounds, NASA said. But the statement added, while such carbon-based molecules are considered the building blocks of life, they also can be formed by non-biological processes. Perseverance uses its robotic arm and drilling equipment to capture rock and soil samples from the Martian surface. So far, it has collected 22 samples. The rover has secured the samples in special containers, and they are to be picked up and returned to Earth during a future mission. Ken Farley is a project scientist with the Perseverance team at Caltech in Pasadena, California. He said, "Chiava Falls is the most puzzling, complex, and potentially important rock yet investigated by Perseverance." Farley said unusual color spots and other structural elements in the samples suggest chemical reactions that might have given energy to ancient microbial life. but he noted that so far scientists have not been able to identify exactly how the rock formed. The team described the rock as containing white veins that may have been created by the substance calcium sulfate. Between the veins, examiners found lines of material with a reddish color. These lines suggest the presence of hematite, a common substance found in many rocks on Earth. David Flannery is an astrobiologist and member of the Perseverance Science Team from the Queensland University of Technology in Australia. He said that on Earth, these kinds of rock elements are often linked with the fossilized record of microbes living in the subsurface. The scientists said the new findings strengthen existing evidence that such rocks may have been created or were changed by flowing water on Mars billions of years ago. Caltech's Farley said the rock sample had already been imaged and examined with lasers, X-ray equipment, and other instruments as much as possible in recent weeks. He noted that Perseverance has done as much as it can to examine the newly discovered samples. Farley added, "To fully understand what really happened in that Martian River Valley at Jezero Crater billions of years ago, we'd want to bring the Chiava Falls sample back to Earth. That way," he said, "it can be studied with the powerful instruments available in laboratories." I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn is here now to talk more about his science report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Of course, Ashley. Glad to be with you.
This week's report was about a new rock discovery made on Mars by NASA's Perseverance Explorer. The scientists noted this finding adds to past evidence that organic matter exists on Mars. How does this latest discovery differ from others in the past?
So one way this discovery was different was that this rock collected by Perseverance gave Earth-based researchers the chance to examine detailed features they really hadn't been able to do until now. And this ability was made possible because of some of the specialized instruments Perseverance uses. One instrument, known as Sherlock, is specifically designed to identify evidence of organic compounds that could suggest past life on Mars. While these instruments have been used before, even detecting what appeared to be organic material, NASA says this time they saw things in the rock that had not been identified before.
All right. Thanks so much for joining me, Bryan, and thank you for that report.
You're welcome, Ashley. Thank you.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Jill Robbins, and I'm joined by Andrew Smith. Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Jill.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Ana introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Ana Mateo.
In Lesson 29 of Level 2 of the series, Ana visits a fire station and learns about how to stay safe in the event of a fire. A fire station is where firefighters keep their fire trucks and things they need to fight fires.
Today, we're going to look at several expressions from Lesson 29. In the beginning of the lesson, Ms. Weaver has asked Anna to learn about fire safety.
Hey, Anna, what are you reading?
I'm reading about fire safety. Ms. Weaver named me Fire Safety Monitor.
But the only time we have a fire emergency is when someone burns a piece of toast.
That is true, but fire safety is very serious, very serious. If there is a fire emergency, I have to help everyone out of the building.
Well then, if I were you, I'd learn as much as possible.
You're right, and I know just who to call.
You may have noticed that Anna used the word monitor.
I'm reading about fire safety. Ms. Weaver named me Fire Safety Monitor.
Monitor is more commonly used as a verb. It means to carefully look at and check on something. But as a noun, we can say that a monitor is a person who watches something carefully.
And it also has another meaning as a noun. A monitor is a screen for showing information or videos. For example, in an airport, monitors show when flights arrive and depart.
Now, let's hear Anna meeting the firefighters at their fire station, which is also called a firehouse.
Hi, Firefighter Jones.
Hey, how are you, Anna?
I'm well, thanks. How are you? Hi, Firefighter Hatcher.
Hi, Anna. How are you?
I'm well, thanks.
Welcome to our firehouse.
Thank you.
Come on in.
Thanks.
This is where the firefighters eat. This is where we rest. This is where we exercise. This is where the fire trucks are parked and maintained.
This place is beautiful.
You know, the firehouse is a firefighter's second home.
In the U.S., firefighters always make sure their fire trucks are in good working condition. This is what the verb maintain means. It is important to maintain equipment or machines so they work well during an emergency.
I also notice that fire trucks in the U.S. always look very clean. The noun form of maintain is maintenance. A collocation or phrase that commonly occurs with maintenance is the expression perform routine maintenance. Here, the verb perform simply means to do. And the word routine is used as an adjective. It means on a regular basis.
So, if you perform routine maintenance on your car or motorcycle, it means you make sure all the parts are in good condition and that you replace or change the parts that are getting worn out. Worn out means old or damaged from overuse.
Sometimes I feel worn out, and you know I have replaced some of my parts.
That's right, the partial knee replacement. Well, I feel worn out too sometimes, especially at the end of the week. Now, let's listen to what the firefighters tell Anna.
Firefighter Jones, Firefighter Hatcher, can you tell me some ways to prepare for a fire emergency?
Sure, Anna. There's one really important thing you can do. It's install a fire alarm. Test it monthly and make sure the batteries are fully charged.
Let's talk about those emergency exits.
In your home, office, and schools, know where your emergency exits are located.
What about fire extinguishers?
Everyone should know how to use a fire extinguisher. Have one handy and practice using it.
What if we need to get out?
You should have an evacuation plan and practice getting out safely with fire drills.
A drill is a practice routine. We can also use this word as a verb. If you drill an activity, That means you practice it in a careful, repetitive way.
For example, you can do grammar or pronunciation drills to improve your English.
But be sure to find or make drills that are interesting and useful.
That's good advice. The firefighters also advised Anna to install a fire alarm.
To install means to put a piece of equipment in place so that it is ready to work or be used.
Anna also asked about extinguishers. I have to admit, Jill, I don't know how to use one.
Andrew, they have very simple instructions written on them. Just read it. An extinguisher helps extinguish or put out a fire. They are usually red bottles that spray a white material that helps put out the fire. And notice what the firefighter said about fire extinguishers.
Everyone should know how to use a fire extinguisher. Have one handy and practice using it.
The word handy is an adjective. It has two meanings. One means the same thing as the adjective useful. The other means that the thing is nearby and easy to start using. You can think of it as easy to grab with your hand. With this second meaning, we often say keep or have something handy.
I think the camera on your phone is a good example of something that is handy. It's both useful and nearby and easy to use, and it's in your hand.
That's right. It's handy in every way. Okay, now let's listen to more advice the firefighters give Anna.
What if we need to get out?
You should have an evacuation plan and practice getting out safely with fire drills.
If I'm in a building and it's on fire, should I use the elevator?
No, always use the stairs.
What other safety tips should I know?
Stay low, the smoke rises, the air is clear close to the ground.
Stay low. Anything else?
If you touch a door and it's hot, don't open it. There might be a fire on the other side.
What do I do if my clothes catch on fire?
Do not run. If you run, the fire will burn faster. You must stop, drop, and roll.
Thanks so much. I've learned a lot, and I can't wait to share this information with others.
Thanks for coming, Anna.
It's been a pleasure meeting you.
Anna received a lot of good tips. A tip means a piece of advice or some helpful information.
Now Anna knows that she needs an evacuation plan in case there is a fire at the office. Evacuate is a verb, which means to move away from a dangerous area or emergency. And evacuation is the noun.
At the end of Lesson 29 of Level 2, Anna does have to help evacuate the building because there is smoke.
And where there's smoke, there's fire.
True, or maybe just some wood that is almost on fire.
Yes, or in this case, just some toast. In the end, the reason there is smoke in Anna's office is because Pete has burned his bread while making toast.
I remember that fire drill. And before we're toast or all worn out, we'll remind our listeners that each lesson of Let's Learn English comes with a lesson plan they can download for free from our website.
And as always, remember that you can find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Dr. Jill.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.